what separates this trail from the other American long distance trails. One is there's so few people. I think there might have been 35 of us, and I this year through hiking, and I've met only about 10 or 12 through hikers. PCT now has near 2,000, the AT 3,000, the Continental Divide's in the hundreds now, like 500.
And I think we were also really enticed by the fact that not that many people do this trail, and you have to navigate and chart your own way, and I mean, in a sense, be a trailblazer, and it seemed really cool to be a part of that, so.
And then the terrain. You'd be hard-pressed to find the diversity of terrain, everything from above glaciers in Glacier National Park and Olympic National Park to walking through cow pastures in central Washington and through towns and some, you know, there's quite a bit of road walking.
And then there's the scrambles through the thorns and the bushes that are taller than we are. A few near breakdowns on those sections.
There are a lot of like moments where you're like disappointed or frustrated, but they always are rounded out, I felt at least, by a reminder of why you're doing it Mother Earth. We came down from the Chuckanuts onto Route 11 around Edison. We're road walking, basically, like what most people, arguably the worst part of the trail. We had our little battery-powered radio. We're listening to like Canadian dance music stations. And the wind's blowing and the sun had come up unexpectedly, and like the tent's flapping on my back, drying out from the last night when I was all pissed off that it was wet. But there's all these people going around like in their lives and with their cars, and they seemed like so tethered and stuff. And we were like, we're so free right now.
The Pacific Northwest Trail was first conceived of by Ron Strickland in the early 1970s. It took nearly 40 years of cutting trail and raising money to acquire land, but in 2009, the PNT was officially designated a National Scenic Trail. The 1,200-mile-long route connects the Continental Divide to the Pacific Ocean. Passing through three states, three national parks, and seven national forests. The physical trail is far from complete, though. It is an evolving patchwork of primary and alternate routes for each hiker to choose his or her own path. Life on the trail is unpredictable and spontaneous. Rigid planning may be effective in regular life, but out here, we have to be flexible. By the end, I had learned a more fluid set of directions by which to live by. Although these directions were learned on the trail, they are universal and can be applied anywhere in life. Unexpectedly, I'm starting with a group of four others: Spaceman Spiff, Marathon, Fitty Shrimp, and Matt. Like me, he doesn't have a trail name yet. first town stop in the tiny outpost of Pole Bridge, Montana. We had to stay an extra day because Friday is pizza night at the Northern Light Saloon. Oh, I've gotten a trail name too. Money Shot.
You don't own a trail name until the first time you introduce yourself as that person. So when I first introduced myself to another hiker as Fitty Shrimp, it was really a strange feeling, but after that, it was pretty normal, just like everything else on the trail. I got out of college at the regular get out of college age and went to go get the traditional job and a better job. And sometimes you lose jobs and you get a different job to take the place of that job. And then, you know, 25 or 30 years later, you realize you really haven't lived. Last year in 2014, I embarked on my first thru hike. It was on the Appalachian Trail. One of the members of our group discovered some food that a hiker had left behind. The one that we selected was the shrimp and rice special. So it was a disaster and we ended up throwing it out. But there was another camper up there with us who told us that we should become the Highway Shrimp Gang. But the only way we could make it cool is if we turned it into a gangsta rap group. So we all had to take on rapper names with a shrimpy twist. So at the time I was 50 years old, and so it became natural for me to become Fitty Shrimp.
My trail name is Marathon, and I got that on the Appalachian Trail where I got into town and they were having a half marathon the next morning. And I talked to the race director and I'm like, hey, you're a thru hiker, you can race for free. So I did that. So Marathon, it stuck.
My name is Spaceman Spiff. It's from Calvin and Hobbes. It's a character, an alter ego of the main character. It's when he's in class, falling asleep, daydreaming, he imagines himself being Spaceman Spiff, traveling the universe, fighting aliens, exploring new planets.
My name is Stumbling Norwegian, and they used to just call me Norwegian, just out drinking with friends. Got up in the morning after staying up till, I don't know, probably 4 in the morning, and got up at like 7 and went hiking, and I was stumbling up the trail, so they just started calling me Stumbling Norwegian.
And I'm Honeybee, and I got my trail name on the PCT in 2011. My hiking partner and I made all of our own hiking food and dehydrated it. And in Big Bear, I was filling up my little jar full of honey that I would carry with me on the trail. And they just looked at that and they said, oh, I bet you made that yourself too, didn't you? And it happened that my parents had beehives. And so I said, well, actually, it was from my parents' beehive that, you know, I helped extract the honey from. So then they named me Honeybee after that.
Oh.
About it. Yeah. Thank you. You have pretty earrings.
I'm Spice Rack. So, look at you. Huh? I'm Spice Rack, and I got my name because I thought it would be a great idea to carry around a mini spice rack with me on the trail at first, which did not make it beyond a few hundred miles, but the name stuck. So.
And I'm Bluebird because I accidentally bought everything blue without realizing. Had blue clothes, blue pack.
Blue shoes.
A little bit. Blue shoes. You know, we quit our jobs and essentially took a break from our lives to have this long breath of fresh air. And so there's that aspect, and also just for the challenge.
The trail name's Freebird. It fits, too. It's like one of my ideals in life and in thru hiking is to be as free as possible. Like, no schedules, no plans, throw the plans out the window, just wing it. And and that's when the real trail magic happens. I have very few ties. Mm-hmm. I don't have a car anymore. I'm house free. And I've been living this life on the trail for many years now, over 10 years basically, almost year round. I've hiked the PCT 3 times. I've hiked the AT 3 times. I've hiked the Continental Divide. I've hiked the length of New Zealand. It's called the Te Aroha. I've hiked the Florida Trail. I'm not a Florida Trail through hiker technically, since I skipped all the road walking. And I've hiked the Hayduke Trail, just did that this spring. Tons of other smaller trails. The John Muir Trail twice, the Long Trail twice. Kalalau Trail about 50 times on Kauai. It's my favorite short trail. I live in Hawaii. The Chilkoot Pass Trail in Alaska, a bunch of hiking in Alaska as well. And one of my favorite short distance hikes, the Lost Coast Trail in California, which is similar to this, coastal walk.
Since Glacier, I've already seen incredible diversity in these mountains. The Flathead National Forest is more subtle, gentle rippling mountains, all tree-covered and similar to its neighbor. The two-story cabin on top of Stull Peak is just a tiny speck from across the valley. I scramble up the ridgeline, bracing the sunset and the approaching rain clouds, and arrive just in time. In the morning, I found some new air vents in my hat, courtesy of the football-sized rats of Stull Peak Cabin.
Three of those is like awesome.
With one national park and a national forest behind us, exhaustion is becoming a constant. When we get to Yak, nobody makes a move all day. So before we know it, we had taken our first zero day.
When you get to town, you eat a lot, and you go to establishments and you loiter a lot. Hardcore loitering in town.
From a physical perspective, it's just really hard to be prepared when you start a thru hike. So you have to understand that the first few weeks are going to be really difficult. 3 to 4 weeks into a thru hike, though, things just start changing and your body adapts to what you're putting it through. My body would say, okay, you know, we're going to do this, but the first thing we're going to do is lose 20 pounds. So get ready for that. And sure enough, 20 pounds, about 3 weeks in, it starts going and you lose about a pound a day for the next few weeks. And then it kind of levels off.
Okay, so I spent 3 months on my first excursion on the AT. And then 5 months the second year I did it. So I had plenty of time to let that lifestyle and those habits settle. I mean, by the time I hit Pole Bridge, which was like just a few days into the hike, I was completely hyper trash again. I spent 3 days in Pole Bridge.
Hiker trash. It's a term of endearment that hikers call each other hiker trash because we look like vagrants. Some of us are vagrants. When we get to town, if it's been wet, you know, out in front of the post office, you'll see like tents hanging from the trees and just socks and all the, it looks like a yard sale or a garage sale.
A few days in, we met Stumbling Norwegian and Honeybee on the trail, and Stumbling Norwegian, you know, got this serious look in his eyes, and it's like, you guys know that if you find a piece of candy on the ground, you have to eat it. And we're like, oh, weird, okay. Like, I don't think we'll get that desperate, but whatever. And it wasn't long before we were finding, like, half-eaten fruit leathers that we just were like, yes, this is awesome. Or sleeping in a bathroom because it was too cold outside. Not even just thinking, it was like, oh my god, this is so awesome.
Or like picking where you sit in a restaurant so that you're strategically closest to the people most likely to not finish their french fries. So you can get there before the busboy does.
Well, you're planning ahead.
Oh yeah. Like that dude's distracted and not that hungry.
Our hitch out of Yak drops us off about 10 miles too far. Marathon and Spaceman decide to try and hitch back. Well, Fitty Shrimp, Matt, and I think we can intersect the trail from here with a couple logging roads.
This is a trail as much as it's gonna be.
Then, the PNT isn't where it's supposed to be, and we get our first real taste of being lost.
Where Fitty at?
Get on the trail!
And just as the sun is setting, a well-worn trail cuts through the featureless brush.
God. We found the trail!
Get on the trail!
We lost Matt in the process, but I have a feeling that he's just fine.
That was hard, dude. That was really hard for me.
Think about how easy the rest of the trail is going to be now.
Sometimes you come to a section where there just is no trail, and the plan is to somehow connect where you are to a magical place 6 miles away from where you are through whatever route you determine to be the most feasible and just hope that it works out okay.
The trail conditions of the AT were so consistent, but the PNT, you've got, you know, a section of perfect trail, and that for, you might have that for like a mile. and then you just, where did this trail go? You can kind of see a cut through the bushes, but it's like all just overgrown, and you just, you know, you're putting up with that for a little while longer. Then it might disappear entirely.
I would say that on this trip, 70% of the time, I've been somewhere between either slightly confused or completely lost. And that's just been a part of this adventure.
I kind of like that, though. You know, keeps you wondering what's next.
This, we felt, would be more of a challenge. Not only physically, but mentally as well. And that's kind of what we wanted, you know, something that it wouldn't just be, you know, one of us following the other person and just mindlessly walking.
Yeah, I mean, this trail is all about choosing your own route. And that's also one of the great things about it.
We choose to take the Northwest Peak alternate route, where we will start our first planned bushwhack. Only this time, there will be no brush, just 100-mile views in every direction. Fitty and I will descend from the peak on sketchy loose rock, then we'll traverse the ridgeline between the next two peaks. At times, the ridge will come to a knife edge, with 1,000-foot drops on either side. Fitty is afraid of heights, so he's not looking forward to this nearly as much as I am. Spaceman and Marathon signed the logbook in the cabin, so at least we know they are somewhere ahead of us. Still no sign of Matt, though.
Traveling on a thru-hike type trail, it's not just a single file line of a bunch of people. Everybody is doing their own thing, and you just meet up whenever you meet up. It could be today, it could be tomorrow. There's been times when I was separated from the others for a week or longer, a couple of different occasions. And that's okay. That's a different kind of hike then. Just you're out doing your own thing for a few days.
It's pretty basic, our activity out here. I mean, basically, you get up and you walk. And then sometimes you take a break, sometimes you eat, sometimes you poop.
You get the roof of your mouth, and you hug it a little bit.
Yeah, sometimes I do that too. I cover up my tracks. Leave no trace.
When I was hiking alone, it was wake up, go back to sleep for 30 minutes. wake up again. Should I have my oatmeal cold or hot this morning?
And then just kind of started waking up whenever it was light.
Yeah, just the sunrise.
And try to get in, I don't know, at least 20 miles.
We tried to be out of camp by 8 at the latest, which would end up being more closer to 8:30.
I pack up all my shit as fast as I can because by that time I'm like, oh man, I should get moving.
She goes in front, I follow behind her to kind of keep a pace to stay together because I hike a little bit faster than she does.
I mean, sometimes barely talk all day, and hours would go by and Eric would be like, hey, remember Pearl on SpongeBob?
Mr. Krabs' daughter.
Yeah. Like all our deep thoughts.
2 hours is about all I can do without having to eat something, or I don't know, just sit for a minute.
So it was like, okay, we're going to have like 2 Clif Bars. So it's like, when I pack up my pack, I carry the Clif Bars, so I'm going to put 2 like an outside of my pouch. And we know that we can eat them before lunch, you know?
Approximately another 2 hours, or until we start feeling hungry, is lunchtime. That usually ends up being an hour. Mm-hmm. And then after that, we usually hike to camp, but we'll have a quick like stand-up break.
No, I don't. I don't have any routine at all, and I don't plan the day. So I just walk and see what happens.
We knew our goal that night, and it was rare that we didn't meet it. If we didn't meet it, it was because we chose not to, like, for a good way. Like, we found a spot that made more sense to camp or looked more fun or decided to push ourselves further because we felt fine or whatever. But, you know, we usually stuck to our plan.
Just after crossing the border into Idaho, Fitty catches up at the Feist Creek restaurant. Cliff, the owner, tells us that Marathon, Spaceman, and Matt are a day ahead of us in Bonner's Ferry. After a free breakfast, he even offers up a ride into town. On the way, we stop at the airport to check out his impressive collection of planes and helicopters.
Our British friend, Matt, Mr. Bean, we call him, realized that the pace we were keeping was not going to meet with his deadline. He had a flight out of Seattle back to England to go to school, so he pushed ahead of us at some point and finished probably a week or more before the rest of us.
The group doesn't feel like leaving town in the rain, so we wait. I'd rather move at my own pace, but I'll have to sacrifice a little bit in order to hike with my new friends. I'm starting to realize that moving slow isn't such a bad thing anyway. When we do leave, a lady named Lynn offers us a ride to the trailhead. Along the way, she even gives a full historical tour of the area along the Kootenai River.
Faster! Faster! We got it!
See ya!
Yes, look at this.
That's gotta be the place, right?
I think so.
Do you suppose this is the saddle?
Yeah, I think this is it now.
Berries.
Follow the berries!
There have been whispers among the hikers lately about the infamous bushwhack, and today we will have to confront it. In Idaho's underrated Selkirk Mountains, we are to traverse the mountainside behind Upper Ball Lake for half a mile. Then we'll descend from the ridge to Lion's Head Creek. From there, our only directions will be to follow the river for 4 miles, or until the end of a trail appears.
We romanticized everything. Just thought, you know, we'd be Indiana Jones, like, swinging from ropes in the bushwhacks, and it was not like that.
Well, this trail is just so young. I mean, that's just part of the trail's coming of age, I guess you should say. You know, you've got to deal with some bullshit before it gets, you know, well established.
Hardest day yet, for the least amount of miles. Occasionally, I'd find a game trail to follow, but most of the time was spent fighting through huckleberry bushes, or just standing there, trying to decide between a bad and a worse route.
When we got to the top of the ridge, there was thunder in the distance, and it started to rain.
I think it might be time to get off of this ridge.
We found what we thought would be the best route down the mountain into a creek valley.
Everybody's saying, where Fitty at?
Where Fitty at?
In the bush!
And we stopped for lunch down there. Just a terrible mess of a place to try to eat lunch.
It's not my kind of hike, I've decided. I like the more traditional, you know,
the trail.
Trail, yeah.
On two different occasions, we were caught in hailstorms that afternoon. I was really getting cold and somewhat hypothermic, so I was able to find a giant rock the size of a house covered with moss, only a couple of small trees on it, and I declared this Fitty Rock, and this is where I was going to camp tonight, and then Marathon agreed that it would be a good idea to stop.
I think one of the lessons from this trail is that, you know, sometimes you end up having to deal with a gnarly bushwhack, and sometimes the best way to deal with that is to set up camp and deal with that shit in the morning, which is what we did exactly.
Yeah, you know, you're probably six into the bushwhack, and I'm climbing up this hill, so I don't realize that half of my pole is gone because I'm just kind of walking like this, and then I look down and realize I only have half of a pole left. The other half are just swallowed up by the forest.
Because that area was so tough, and because, you know, we all mention it as the bushwhack, it kind of was a unifying experience for all of us.
Cold last night. It dropped down into the 30s. Today, it's 85 as I climb 3,400 feet to the top of Lookout Mountain. I lost Fitty and Marathon in the bushwhack, but by now I trust that everyone can handle themselves. I'll see them when I see them. According to my watch, it has been 25 days since I left Glacier, but the life I took a break from at home feels like it is years in the past. Out here, every day feels like a week, because each moment is filled to the brim with something new. I entered the third and final state of the PNT tonight. So much has happened already, it's hard to believe that 75% of the trail is still ahead of me, in Washington. One of the few famous trail angels on the PNT lives in Medellin Falls, and a bubble of hikers are already in town when I arrive. Mary Kate treats all 11 thru hikers in town to a gourmet hiker feed of steak and potatoes.
I wasn't expecting no trail angels. And they just kept on popping up out of the woodwork. And it's like, oh, well, come stay at our place. And
exactly.
Okay, cool.
One of the biggest parts of the trail is the community. I mean, I probably wouldn't have finished my AT hike or this hike if it weren't for the people around me that I was hiking with.
Not only the community of hikers, but the communities that you walk into and meeting the locals.
Mm-hmm.
That could make for a favorite section, like going into Medellin Falls and meeting Trail Angel Mary Kate.
Mm-hmm.
That absolutely made that town wonderful.
The trail community and the bigger trails is kind of stale anyway, for the most part. You do have a wonderful community, but it's kind of like take a number, you know, sign up for the shower. But this trail community is completely fresh and new.
Unbelievable generosity, and those experiences with meeting all these great people along the way, that's a part of the overall adventure. So to bypass those opportunities and just continue on because of some pace that you're trying to keep on the trail, I think you're cheating yourself out of the bigger and better part of the whole process.
And there's a certain vulnerability to it too, because you start a trail knowing that you're going to rely on other people. Mm-hmm. Like getting into town, you're going to be hitchhiking sometimes, and that's putting yourself out there saying, I'm going to need help from others to be able to make this work.
A thru hike can definitely restore your faith in humanity.
Yes.
Yeah, knowing
that there's a ton of helpful, nice, wonderful people out there. You know, it's not all the death and destruction you hear on the news all day long. You know?
Wildfires are popping up all around us, and Washington is on track to have a record-breaking fire season this year. A new one has closed the trail between Medellin Falls and Northport, but Mary Kay was nice enough to give us a ride around it. I get the feeling that this won't be the only fire we have to deal with, though.
It was absolutely gorgeous, beautiful blue sky weather, and noticed fire smoke. I couldn't believe what I was seeing, you know, because the only fire I knew of at the time was the Wolverine fire, which was like 40,000 plus acre fire at that time. But it was the fire smoke was coming from the wrong direction. And I'm like, what's going on? Fire smoke was starting to fill in the valleys, and then you drop down and start heading west, and right into fire smoke. And it was like that the rest of the way for another 2 days of hiking. There was ash falling. So that kind of scared us a little bit because we didn't know what was going on. You know, we didn't know where this fire was at. Once that valley fills up with smoke, then you don't know what direction it is. You don't know if you're walking right into a fire even. You know, and luckily we weren't.
Leaving Northport, we entered the cattle country of eastern Washington. Ahead, there are 30 miles of road walking before we'll even see a trail.
I think all the road walking, though, made me appreciate trails more than I did before hiking this trail. And just all the work that it goes into making a trail and maintaining a trail. And I definitely want to do some trail maintenance myself. Just, I think I have a new appreciation for what goes into making a trail.
The roads cannot stand the roads, even if it's nice pavement, if it's gravel. Part of my feet, ground's more compact and very long. Time doesn't seem to go by as quickly as when you're on trail.
You'd hike 6 miles to your campsite on a road, and then knowing the next day you still got another, like, say, 4 miles of road walking to do before you reach a dirt road that you would still walk on for another 6 miles to reach possibly a trailhead. You think it's a trail, but it's probably just an overgrown dirt road that has become trail. So that, I think, was, like, also mentally tough.
The road is much harder on my body than the trail, but the exhaustion has had some interesting side effects. My mind is less cluttered as I walk. Slow steps, each one reminding me of how tired my legs are, but no step is worse than the last. My breathing is rhythmic, increasing and decreasing with the hills. This is the meditative walking I imagined, but I didn't know it would take total exhaustion to find it. Water has been hard to find lately in the high desert country of the Okanogan National Forest. This morning, I drank my last few gulps, knowing that there wouldn't even be a chance to fill up for the next 5 miles. Temperatures rise above 100 degrees, but Oroville, Washington is just 15 miles away, and soon enough, I'll be sipping on a milkshake. It's actually a PNT sign.
We're here.
Oh, wow.
Now you're here. And we have to go there.
The longest official section on the PNT is next, the Pasaten Wilderness. Leaving the halfway point of Oroville, we won't have another chance to resupply for 160 miles. The guidebook says we won't even see a road for a week. My pack is full to the brim with 9 days of food, but now that we are out of cattle country, I have a good feeling about what's ahead. Thank you. The guidebook describes the Pasayton Wilderness as, if you have good weather, the Pasayton will be epic. If you don't, it will still be epic, just not in a good way. Deep into this long section, the PNT merges with another epic trail, the PCT. We are to follow it southbound for 15 miles, for what is supposed to be some of the best views on either trail.
Yeah, you can't control everything that's going to happen. And yeah. I think that's a really powerful part of the trail, because you do have to let go, and what you need will be provided in one way or another. Yeah. And just trusting that.
Understanding the unknown is not something that's scary. That it's accepting, and that we're resilient people, and you could figure out what to do.
Yeah, when we got into Ross Lake, there was the whole New Hingham fire happening. So the whole resort was closed down. People were leaving.
Yeah, there were eight total. Eight fires total. They called it the Upper Skagit Complex.
There was fires on the other side of the lake when we got to the lake. And it was like on the ridge of the valley that our trail goes through.
Out here, my senses are always being exercised, and I feel more in tune with my environment. I find myself picking up on subtleties that I didn't even know existed.
Although Ross Lake was pretty sweet, all the guests had to evacuate because of the fire by order of the Park Service. The owner was like, well, we have empty cabins and you guys are here anyway. You can just make yourself at home in one of our cabins. So we had this amazing resort all to ourselves. And on top of that, when the guests were evacuated, they left lots and lots of good food that we made use of.
Luckily, the only open route into the North Cascades National Park is the one that we have to take, the Big Beaver Trail. This park holds most of the glaciers that exist in the continental United States, and I make it a point to camp up high next to them when I can. Groans and creaks from the Hannigan Glacier echo through the canyon as I write in my journal for the night. The hiker hunger is in full force now. I can't eat enough, and my energy is suffering. It's been 12 days since Oroville, and our next town stop is still 3 days away. The guidebook says that there is a small camp store at the Swift Creek campground, which I'm banking on because I barely have 2 days of food left at this rate.
I almost just walked straight into that. There's a trail behind him.
There is no camp store at the Swift Creek campground, so I'll be surviving off donations for the next 24 hours. I'm starting to notice a rhythm to this hike. There are highs and lows. It's not always up to you when those ups and downs come, but it's important to keep moving. Just when I had lost hope of catching a ride into concrete, a police car pulls up next to me, with Marathon in the passenger seat. Turns out, the officer is a hiker too.
For me, it's like every time you near town and are in town and leave town, there's sort of, you know, your like humanity, civilization thing sensor goes up, mm-hmm. like cascades up when you're exciting town, and then you're like up there with the root beer and the cell service and everything, and then back down, you know, as you know you're confronting the trail again. And once, you know, on that back down, when you're going back into the trail, it's like you fall back into the rhythm of the trail. And for me, that means like going to bed when it's dark out and getting up when it's light out and not feeling this like bio, like chemical need to check my cell phone that you feel in town.
Well, I think what they're talking about is that the clutter in their mind starts to dissipate after a few weeks, and then they fall into a rhythm or a flow of walking the trail where there's less effort involved. You've got your trail legs, you're in shape, and you just kind of flow along.
I always felt some kind of like deep relief when we were back out again and just hiking, and we didn't have all these different distractions and things we could do, because the only thing we had to do was just walk.
The Pasayton and the North Cascades back to back took a lot out of us, and we could use a break in the upcoming terrain. Since we are in concrete already, we decide to take the Rails to Trails alternate into Anacortes. The next 2 weeks will be a polar opposite from the previous two. This alternate and the Puget Sound area is the most populated part of the trail, and we'll have the convenience of town almost every day. The PNT is always fluctuating from one extreme to the next, and sometimes very rapidly. From bushwhack to perfect trail, high desert to lush rainforest, and now wilderness to metropolis.
You know, we can get so set in our ways mm-hmm. for such a long time that it's like to do anything else is strange and even taboo sometimes. But on the trail, it's nothing but change. Mm-hmm. Everything's changing constantly. The weather, you know, your location, your gear is doing weird stuff. Your food's, you know, there and gone before you know it.
Hiking the trail, I kind of discovered the reasons to be out there, I guess. And for me, it was the simplicity of life for those few months. You know, I didn't have everything that you have to think about when you're working and renting an apartment or a house, to have months, you know, of every day you're out seeing beautiful scenery. For me, it's a way to really just recharge and reset.
I'm much more present or in the moment, appreciating right here, right now, than I used to be. I was always planning for the future, worrying about the future, or ruminating over the past, and never actually living day by day. So when people now ask me, you know, when I'm backpacking on one of these trails, they say, well, where do you live? And I say, right here, right now. This is where I live. And then they're like, come on, really? I'm like, no, really. Right here, right now. Like I said, one of the beauties of thru hiking is you've got to lose self-consciousness. Well, we all do. And it's just like how vain the world is, and like wearing fancy clothes and trying to look, you know, trendy or fashionable. It's kind of pathetic.
It's in focus when you come off the trail, how much that dominates our culture. And just how much we look at somebody and by what they're wearing or how they're doing what they're doing, make all these assumptions about them. And when we're standing, like, looking like hobos, needing a ride, and some high school kid drives by and says, get a job, it's funny because you're like, you know, I just, like, quit, like, a pretty cool job in D.C. where we were, like, influencing policy to come out here and, like, hike 1,000 miles to where I'm standing right now, you know. And this person driving by has no idea of that. And it's almost relieving or liberating to, like, not need to tell that person all that stuff.
And for me, too, it's so rewarding to push your body to a level that maybe you haven't before, and just to find out what you're capable of. I mean, I feel like we're really meant to walk. Humans are just walkers, you know. Mm-hmm. Anyone can go out and do this. It's just making that decision to go hike.
Shut up. You can do it. You can do it. You just don't feel like putting the effort into planning and quitting your shitty job. Anybody can be one. If you can walk, you can do it.
A black sheepdog quietly greets us near a farm. He quickly assumes the role as pack leader and shows us the way for the next 5 miles. When we reach Deception Pass Bridge, we decide it's time to call the number on his collar. The veterinarian transfers us to local police, who transfer us to animal control, who just don't want to help. Yeah, he got bored at home. He's ready for an adventure. Bad timing. We feed him what we can that night, and he camps with us. The next morning, a park ranger finally takes him off our hands. But now that he's gone, we kinda miss him. Brand new trail angels have given us a place to stay for the past 3 nights in a row, including one couple that we met way back in Glacier on our first night of the hike. When they discovered that the PNT practically ran through their backyard in Oak Harbor, they offered us homebrew and beds to sleep in, if we made it that far. Next stop is Port Townsend, after a quick ferry ride across the Puget Sound. My body is well rested, and my hiker hunger has been quenched. Now, I'm looking forward to getting back into the wilderness. The route I plan to take through the Olympics will be just as long as the Pasayan Wilderness. With another 160-mile section ahead, I didn't know that simply getting there would be the hardest part.
You know, we had to hike on highways to get to that road. Route 20, which turns into 100, and it's major freaking highways. Yeah. No shoulder. From those highways, you don't directly go to Snow Creek Road. I spent maybe an hour and a half sitting on the track of my GPS, walking back and forth on this road. Where is this trail? Like, there's just nothing.
But it turned out to be nothing.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. Absolute nothing.
We were looking for a trail that probably doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, then it just got thick. Oh my gosh, it got thick.
Thorns wrapped around me and stinging nettles, and I can't even move. You know, I probably should have a job at home, you know, where I can make money and support myself and do normal things, and here I am. This is like, is this really a good life decision for me to even be out here? And I never had any moments like that on the AT.
After weeks of gluttony in towns, today was a brutal welcome back from the PNT. I lose Fidian Marathon, and my route quickly deteriorates into hellish conditions as darkness falls. I have no choice but to set up camp in the thorns. The next morning, the bushwhack only continues to thicken. At the end of a very long 9-mile day, I find a rocky overlook on Mount Zion. The stress of the day melts away as the sun sets on the leading edge of the Olympic mountain range. I haven't seen a soul for 3 days now. Ego virtually dissolves when there are no other egos to feed it. I'm only thinking about myself when my aching body complains about the miles. Otherwise, my thoughts are distant and free-flowing.
I'm on top of Bolcachil Peak right now. It overlooks the Seven Lakes area, and it's supposed to have some of the best views on the PNT, but right now it's pretty foggy.
Fourth day of rain in a row, with no sign of it letting up. For the past couple days, I have been descending out of the last mountain range on the PNT. When the fog finally breaks, the mountains are gone, just rolling hills from here to the Pacific Ocean. But first, a much-needed stop in the town of Forks, Washington. With Marathon still a couple days behind, Fiddy and I set out to cover the last 18 miles to the ocean. From then on, we'll be walking northwest up the Pacific coast to the westernmost point of the contiguous United States, Cape Alava. I wasn't sure how I'd feel when I saw the ocean, but it's a powerful feeling, a massive sense of accomplishment, and very surreal because this new landscape is almost mythical. Only 33 miles of beach between us and the western terminus.
It's not all about finishing. It's the people you meet along the way. It's your experiences, your shared experiences amongst your friends and fellow thru hikers.
Our official finish is at Cape Alava, which is the westernmost point of the contiguous United States, which is a fitting end. So, I mean, this is pretty cool. We start on the Continental Divide, which is the watershed. The water west of the Continental Divide, of course, ends up in the Pacific. And so we walk up and over the divide from the east side in Glacier National Park, and then have walked all the way out to where all the water ends up, the Pacific Ocean.
I feel like it was a really cool way to end a trail, though, that just the coast, the beach walk.
Mm-hmm.
That was unique for a long trail and just totally different scenery.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, slow hiking at times.
Real slow hiking.
But it was kind of good to, it forced us to slow down and enjoy our last few days on the trail.
An unfathomable coincidence manifests on the last night of this unfathomable hike. The combination of a lunar eclipse, harvest moon, and supermoon rises from the east. 4 miles short of the end, a perfect bluff rises above the trees to watch it from. So we decide to draw the hike out for one more day.
The last little chunk kind of sucked because it was a lot of decomposing seaweed and dead fish, and it smelled terrible.
Not potato then.
Yeah, kind of a scummy trail end.
We got to Cape Alava and we weren't even sure if we were there. Like, there's no sign saying that we're done. It's just a point that sticks out a little bit farther than all the other, you know, headlands on the beach.
Just like the rest of the PNT, we're not really sure we're in the right spot, but this seems like the end.
I think it'd be nice, though, if they erected some sort of monument.
Yeah. Or a sign. You know,
or at least a sign.
Something.
PNT emblem, like, somewhere.
Yeah, even just an emblem up on a tree or something.
You know, that says you're done.
Or you're just beginning.
Or you're just beginning, yeah.
After the initial woohoo of finishing, we're like, okay, well, now what do we do?
Yeah, it's just, it's weird, most of all, because it's, you've accomplished a huge thing, but it's an inevitable beginning of a transition that, if it's not unknown, it's at least a little awkward.
Kind of bittersweet, very, very bittersweet. It's just one of those things where it's, you got to move on either way. You know, you can't live out there forever.
Ended up being really cool to hike such a young trail, I think. Just to see it in a different stage and imagine, you know, hiking the PCT back in the 70s or when it was a young trail and kind of thinking, oh, it might have been similar to this in places. And we'll probably go hike it again in 20 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hike your own hike means just that, you know. You don't owe anybody else an explanation for what you're doing. If you want to skip a 10-mile stretch of dangerous highway walking, then do it. You know, if you want to be able to look back at the end and say, I walk every single step, you know, from here to here, that's great too. Hike your own hike.
Reaching the terminus of my first thru hike was surprisingly insignificant. I had already experienced the extremes of this trail. Cape Alava just meant that it was over, and I wasn't quite sure how to feel about that yet. I got to experience this trail at a unique time in its life, and everyone seems to agree that this year was a breakout year for the PNT. Somewhere between 35 and 70 hikers might not seem like a lot, but it's at least doubled since last year. As the PNT grows, the increase in recognition will inevitably solidify its route into a single red line on the map. Every year, more and more of the guesswork will be eliminated, and with it, a little bit of the adventure. I'm excited to see the PNT mature in the future, but I'm grateful that I got to experience it while it's still untamed. 1,200 miles, 87 days, July 4th through September 28th. I have lived more between those dates than I have in the past many years.
We'll be right back. most annoying traits?
Where do I start? I can do this. When I drink water, I gulp.
And how much water do you drink?
Almost 10 liters of water a day. Oh, I pee a lot because I drink a lot. Sometimes I just pee like, right on the trail. I'll pee while walking. The burp fart, that is my claim to fame. Patent pending currently. You burp and then stick your tongue out and make a fart noise. It sounds pretty dumb.
It is pretty dumb.
It is pretty dumb.
Good.